first violinist, man.
Oh, wow.
It's still good. The guy's in the workshop busy.
Did you ever think that you would play with a symphony?
With the orchestra?
No, I never thought that that we'd be playing with a symphony ever.
It's not something that ever really entered my mind, like a dream type of thing.
I think purists would argue that am I playing classical music? I'm playing with classical music.
When I was heavily into classical music, I had, you know, aspirations to one time actually pick up maybe a cello or a violin just to, like, get a little bit more inside the music.
I wouldn't say that I was completely ignorant to classical music, but I wouldn't say that it was knocking on the back door of my Deep Purple records.
I mean, I've entertained ideas, certainly, of mixing and crossbreeding every possible instrument and players and turntablists and whole horn sections, but not ever a full, even more than a couple cellos.
Hey, Neuter.
Hey.
No, none of that. Nope. It didn't interest me at all. There were some classical guitar players, you know, that were playing, you know, Bach pieces that at one point I, you know, had my Spanish guitar out and thought I was really good, you know, but, at the end of the day, you know what feels best.
Yeah.
You play what you play, man, and that's big fat guitars.
And we're right into the symphony. What do you think? My tux on.
Most everybody's here, right?
Just about.
Michael Kamen actually is the person who approached us and asked us if we were interested in doing something with the San Francisco Symphony.
This is one of the most respected symphony orchestras in the world, and Michael Kamen felt our music was really suited for that type of interpretation.
He's worked with us before on Nothing Else Matters and a few other rock things that he's done, so he's bridged the two worlds a couple times before.
That's what I wake up and do, is I play my music, which is really a combination of rock and roll and classical music.
We made the decision, you know, to do this project in the fall of 97, stayed in touch constantly. Michael came out and spent some time with us on the road.
Metallica are about the loudest band you could possibly invent. And although I've done it with Pink Floyd and orchestra, I've done it with Eric Clapton and orchestra, I've done it with Bob Dylan and orchestra, this is the first time we've ever actually taken it to the full tilt and said, Metallica.
Take that mini disc, plug it in.
It's so horny to do this.
Horny to do this?
Yeah, they are. I mean, the brass players were like salivating over the parts, looking at the music and going, it took me 2 minutes to go, bum, 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 because they went, da, 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 bum, bum, bum. And I went, no. And they played it exactly.
I wasn't sure what to expect. I kind of thought it was going to be where he just, you know, deciphers the Metallica music and kind of the rigidity of the riffs and the 4-4-8-4, you know, all these things, and kind of just enhance those parts and go along with us. And I didn't know how else to hear it.
At the end of the rehearsal, the orchestra stood up and then all the orchestra personnel, the honchos and rumble, came and said, no, they never do.
Yeah.
And it is true. Orchestras never give anything away.
So that's a good sign.
It's a very good sign.
There's plenty of skeptics out there. Oh, it's not going to work. People shaking their head. And this has to be taken with, you know, a grain or two of salt, because this is just, it's all about having fun and trying something new. If it fails, hey, all you can say is we tried. But if it's great, then it'll be even sweeter.
Now they're more secure about themselves, and there's no question that Metallica are Metallica. So this doesn't raise questions. This is just an experiment, and it's a pretty far out one, pretty brave.
Can you give it to me again?
It's a good time to play for the
night. I'm gonna think about that for the rest of my life.
There's no caviar. There's no champagne. There's no foie gras. No? I think I'm underpaid.
So now you should probably hear it. Where's the record button?
The cool thing about having this type of pre-production time, upfront time, was that, you know, time was on our side. I think, you know, probably a couple of months out, we knew
what 20 songs are going to be.
It was great.
Was your Cthulhu? Run Cthulhu?
Yeah, we have Cthulhu. That was the first thing we played. Put Cthulhu in.
Cthulhu.
You know, you're not playing that song, right?
Which one? Yeah, right?
No. So what? So fucking what?
You did strings for that?
I don't think so.
No.
I could do strings for that, but I don't know if you'd get them to play it. They'd be playing, and suddenly you go, so what? So fucking... And you'd stop me. So what? So I think your fucking grandmother would fuck her.
And Michael came in with a mini disc and recorded the live performance of 50 pieces of the orchestra and the first time that they'd seen it in the paper.
They didn't know what to expect. Most of them have never heard Metallica. And for them, a piece of music is something that they can play no matter what it is. I mean, the common expression is they'll play fly shit. You know, if you put fly shit on a piece of paper and give it to a musician, he'll play it.
Michael would take the album versions and he would basically put the basic orchestra arrangement over the album version so we could hear what the ideas were.
Titanic?
I love this part. Their piece by itself is an epic thing that you would use for a movie soundtrack without even bat, you know. Immediately, yes, we'll take it. But the Metallica thing by itself, we know what that is and what that represents. These guys are making it so colorful and so many dimensions are added by the different things and the way that they hear this stuff.
Stage.
Huh?
Yeah, yeah.
The
whole stage.
It's lovely.
It was great.
Anyway, you like the orchestra?
That
sounds good.
Sounds great just by itself.
Work? Yeah, I know, yeah.
It's like, can't we do like two nights with us and one night with the orchestra? We can sit out and enjoy a couple cocktails, you know? Working with Michael Kamen is just like working with another person who's in the band. And for all intents and purposes, he is in Metallica for this project.
He's very passionate, easygoing, very open. From a personality point of view, it worked really well, so that made it a little easier.
In your corner, boys.
He's got his hands full with this. You know, it's pretty interesting, and I don't know how in the hell he does it. He's up there, you know, making little things in the air. All I know is when he makes a pentagram, that's when I come in.
Yeah.
A good working relationship, you know, where Michael was coming from and an opportunity to work with him, not just do the project with any guy, but so that was the attraction.
Should we carry on?
You should go over two new songs.
We're playing two new songs, No Leaf Clover and Minus Human.
I think we felt that there would be another level of excitement to the project if there would be some material that was not just foreign to them, but also foreign to us.
These are two songs that Lars and James got together a couple weeks ago.
Me and James met up at the very tail end of March, and we basically wrote two songs, like, really quickly.
They're kind of a little wobbly here and there, and...
Clover.
Okay, go.
Roll me over in the clover.
No Leaf Clover, that's been sitting around on tape for 2 years or more.
It has a certain melancholy and dementia at the same time because of the way the tone that James chooses and the way the dynamic each time it comes around. But really psycho, kind of a little bit not right, at the same time being kind of gets you a little bit, you know, touching.
A bit more melodic and having sort of more dynamic elements.
At first I didn't like it when he does it at the end where he does that little thing with his voice, a little squeaky thing with his voice, come to me, that bit. But now I find myself just, it comes to my head, so it's catchy.
It wasn't written for the orchestra, but I think it's the best one that will lend itself to, you know, have them add at least a new dimension to it.
Yeah, come on, I'm Hawaiian now, come on. Mine is human.
But get the other guitars on. Start from the top. Again, with that, let me start.
Minus Human thing is really cool. I love that.
It's just some big, fat, heavy, ugly song that we thought was fitting for here, to rumble the place a bit.
It's very like Fu Manchu and Caius, real simple, tuned down. Let the tones of the way the strings are flapping on the neck, let that be the presence of the song. Sad But True gets close to that, kind of in the same taste, but nothing that's quite drawn back like that. It's real simple, riffed out with that overblown tones.
A little wobbly here and there, you know, a lot of the parts aren't particularly finalized.
Does it turn around?
Yeah.
Okay, one other thing to try though, try the cymbals, like bish, 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 down, down, and in.
Like a different feel. I mean, I could do it once in a while or something.
I think what we all feel is that it's like a flat piece of cardboard. There's nothing happening. There's not a lot of vocals. The riffs are not, you know, very frantic. There's just nothing dynamically happening.
I like the way the drums sit back and don't accentuate a guitar hit. That's what I think makes the riff stand out. It's just unlike anything we've ever done.
This is maybe when, if we do the riff twice, do it at the top of the second time.
Didn't know these songs very well, and so there was an experimental or sort of almost sort of fumbling your way blindfolded through these songs, which is not a bad thing. Which, you know, can really bring out great energy.
Should I do that every time?
Cool.
I think both of them actually have turned out really, really well. I'm proud of both of them, and I'm proud of what Michael did with them.
What's happening on Monday is that we have a morning rehearsal in which we'll try to get mostly down in the first half, mostly. Don't get ambitious, because the main thing that rehearsal is for them to get acquainted with the fact that they're making music with you guys on stage.
Would you think this is right, Michael? When you say morning, is it you and the band,
no,
or is it...
This is correct.
So rock and roll morning.
Yeah, right. Okay, first. First, it'll be light. It'll look like morning, isn't it? I mean,
I've never been there.
But you're more used to playing in much bigger places.
We're in Berserkly, Berkeley Community Theatre. Metallica with 104 backup musicians.
Metallica's taking up too much room. Look at all that. Where am I supposed to park?
Special. I think this is the perfect size. Intimate, not too huge. It's just strange looking up and seeing how small the PA looks.
Not only are we here with the symphony playing and playing Metallica songs, but we're also on the very same stage that Jimi Hendrix played.
This is the most exciting point of my career. Look at me tremble.
That was the first day of full-on rehearsals with them.
Definitely exciting, unknown, a little intimidating. Just in sheer numbers, you know, there's like 100 plus of them and four of us, you know what I mean?
After hearing the first bit of it, like half of the orchestra playing the music, has put a whole new light on everything. And before, I wasn't quite sure what was going to happen. I was telling everybody, I don't know if it's going to be good, but you can come and watch it anyway. You know, it's going to be interesting.
But now I got a feeling it's gonna be really fucking incredible. So as long as everybody's able to count their twos and fours, everything should be fine.
What's your step?
This is gonna be interesting. This is me and my tux right here.
Whenever you're out of your element, it's a great thing because it's fun and you're vulnerable and you feel naked.
Well, we don't know what the effect is yet. I am confident that it'll be great, but I don't know how great, and I don't know if that opinion will be shared by everybody in the hall.
I think that I'm not going to be able to see Lars, though, if Michael is there, so I'm just going to have to be switched a little bit.
I don't mind standing there. I think it's reasonable. I don't mind standing here. I don't want to stand here.
I need to shift though a little bit. So are you going to go?
Let's make whatever shift we individually feel.
I need to shift where? I need to kind of come out this way.
Play right back here when they're all getting it rock on,
right? Right, right.
And
that's great.
The oboes and bassoons.
All right.
Yeah.
I'll be in the string section with my old six strings.
Woodwind.
I think we have so many different angles, JB, that it's more important that we are, like you said at the beginning, that we're comfortable where we're sitting, yeah, and that we can make the music, and then you capture the performance.
This is an excellent idea, though. Just make sure that the musicians all around me know that I'm going to come up.
Yeah.
So that, you know, when they see me coming toward them, they don't freak out like, you know, they hit a bad note. Not like, you know, I hit a bad note. Ever hit bad notes. Ever.
Ever. Ever. Ever.
What time do we start with the symphony?
3:30 with the symphony. Yeah. They're supposed to start arriving at 2:45 to get themselves tuned up here.
Right away with the symphony, it seemed like there was a good rapport with everybody.
The second violinist tried to steal my sandwich earlier. She was eyeballing it.
A few of the cats that really look like they belong in the symphony, a few of those guys, I'm not sure if they'll really give a snot one way or the other. It's like, I'm here, I'm making my wage, and I'm doing my thing.
The harp player back there's got some big guns on him and tattooed, kind of ironic.
I tried to, like, right away, go talk to the bass players immediately and do this thing and say, all right, unite. They were all way cool.
I'm not supposed to talk to them. They're union.
As we got further and further into that, started having polite conversation and, you know, just it definitely very, very quickly became very comfortable.
What's your name?
I'm Eugene Isaacson.
I'm Lars.
I know who you are.
It'll never work, man. Never.
Remember, this is a big secret project I was telling you about.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
What I thought I'd do, Lars, is start the rehearsal with Tulu, having them play it to you.
Okay.
Maybe you play a little bit so they get the beginning of a feel for what it's like to play with drums, and then we launch it.
Only musical issue is just in our starts and stops,
yeah,
where there's a lot of things where we're just used to sort of feeling it. We're halfway through a song, and now we're just gonna start the next part whenever we damn feel it.
Right.
What I'd like to start with is the brand new version in the right key of the Call of Cthulhu. And I'd like to play it for the members of the tower.
I usually don't play music that is composed by people that are still alive. This time they're playing music that is composed by people that are very alive and right there in their face at the same time.
There are two bits of music called Call of Cthulhu. One of them is a half tone lower than the other. That's the only one we are interested in. Somebody is playing from the old music. One half tone apart from everybody.
That's pretty good ear. That's pretty good ear. Hear one guy that's a half a tone out of 100.
They really do read their music, but I think Michael Kamen has really told them, you've got to listen. You've got to listen to outside things now.
I think they expected big whole notes and to be playing like, and instead, they're working as hard as Metallica.
I can't hear too much of them in my ear monitors, but I know when the floor starts rumbling, something good's happening.
Yeah. I can feel the power. hour behind me, and I can feel the cellos bowing their cellos, and I can feel the brass sustaining notes, and I mean, their presence is definitely felt on stage.
You'll see in bar four, a bar of 3/8 has no particular function in time, except to encompass the chant. Give me fuel, give me five, give me...
Five.
Give me five!
Five. It sounds like this.
Kirk will play something. After he's finished playing it, I will bring you in on bar one of Fuel.
Michael came, and he's basically the metronome. I have to be counted into certain parts because everyone's in, you know, time signature. There are times live when we just, things just hang. Oh, okay, I'll start the riff now, you know. But you can't do that, so that's a little difficult.
The cohesive thing, that's what I'm concerned about. Okay, the snare drum, we have a plexiglass up, because at first the snare drum, they're like... you know, you look at someone, the face just going, this guy's looking at this guy. These people are so advanced. They'll rise to the occasion.
Is it a break already?
15-minute break, I guess.
Is it a break?
I'm joining their union.
Every time there's a break, they disappear somewhere, and we're just left to our own.
They're just on a roll, and they gotta take a break, man.
I think the back wall looks amazing.
It's a bit fucking hippie trippy.
It's all gone liquid now.
Some of it's working out really good. Some of it's a little, ugh. What song are they playing? But when it clicks, it's mighty happening.
So much love in this movie.
Some journeys you undertake and you don't really know where you're gonna end up. Sometimes when we start a record, I know what it's gonna look like and feel like and sound like before we start. This was a little more, this could sort of go in a lot of different directions, and I felt that at least I was very open to wherever the ride would take me.
Do you really have to film us while we're getting dressed?
It's like my voice are getting ready for the prom. I'm so excited.
As far as being in a band at high school, it was, you know, the garage band. It was jamming on Thin Lizzy cover songs.
Or better glue it down.
Get dressed up, man. Wearing a jacket? Holy shit. Fuck that.
I was not into wearing any uniforms or showing up at to anything on time, like a rehearsal or anything.
That's what I got. Oh, you polished my biker boots? Cool.
I had my trusty assistant do it.
Now I'm dressed up.
Fuck off with that thing. I was never in a high school band. We don't have high school bands in Danish high schools.
I wasn't in band at all. I was in guitar one. And I only took that class because I knew I could get an easy A.
That's really getting dressed up. That's super dressed up right there. Junior high school was in regular band and marching band. I marched with the baritone saxophone. And I was about 80 pounds soaking wet. The instrument was as big as me and still had to have the, you know, full uniform with the tassel deal and all that with that freaking boom.
As far as what we're gonna dress now, I mean, since we're just gonna run that through and then go into the dress rehearsal, I guess it's up to you on how you wanna dress.
Well, it's gonna be a break before the dress rehearsal.
Well, yeah, they take their breaks. So, I mean, that would probably be a good natural place to have them break. Before, and then come back fresh from the break right into the dress rehearsal.
The school was hip enough to have like a little jazz ensemble, and the one guy played electric bass, Tom something. And when I met him, I had already had bass, you know, at home, but I just went ooh and stuff on it, you know, I had no idea. And this guy was like playing notes and doing this stuff with the band. I'm like, wow, man, this is really cool.
Because there's room for me to get in front of the bass, it's like right here, and I could get with you guys.
Well, you can come from here. I mean, I'll let you through here.
I remember that I was so impressed that he had that thing and could plug it in and make it go. Man, that was really something. That was probably one of my first people I was really impressed by for the instrument, to recognize the bass as something that I really liked.
Hey, thanks for the project. I think it's really cool. I hope you guys enjoyed this. Yeah, I think so.
You guys are doing it.
Yes.
1963 is when I was born. And flames have some significance to this side of my body. A reminder that, you know, you are alive and stay alive. Wasn't there a movie? Staying alive, staying.
Turn around. I can't see.
Binocular.
Now's the time to fart.
No, don't do it. Stop. There you go.
Thank you.
One more little thingy.
When you're down there, don't say a little thingy, okay?
No, I can't.
Okay.
What are you doing?
You're running into me.
The fuck? Get your hands out. Fucking hair. Ugh. You know, gotta do every fucking thing myself.
For a while during the 80s, I was heavily into classical music. I listened to a lot of Bach, a lot of Handel, a lot of Scarlatti, a lot of Canon, a lot of Baroque music, which is very compatible on guitar. And a lot of classical guitar players play a lot of Baroque.
It's hard not to like Bach. It's hard not to like Mozart. That's just really listenable, wonderful music. I always liked Paganini. That was probably one of the earliest things that I listened to because of the frantic riffage on a string instrument like that.
People sit there and, you know, what are your hardcore fans going to think? You know, what would Cliff Burton think? Well, actually, you know, like, Cliff Burton would actually, like, really dig this because he was one of the four of us that actually sat there and studied classical music. And I remember the first year when we were hanging out with him, I mean, he would bring up classical records, you know, bring, you know, ZZ Top and fucking, you know, Lynyrd Skynyrd and Simon and Garfunkel, and then it'd also be like Johann Sebastian Bach's fucking seventh overture in G minor or something. Me and James would sit there and go like, where are the Motorhead records?
Thank you.
Some of the earlier stuff was written almost with a metal kind of orchestration in there, trying to be grand, trying to be epic sounding. No, all of that stuff was done innocently. Michael came and he says, well, don't you know that song's in 6, 7, 2, 3, 5/8, you know? I have no idea what you're talking about. He said, that's amazing stuff. And the orchestra is just, wow, how did they write that? And there's no thought put into it. It's just pure innocence. And we put it down and we thought, wow, we'll just chop something out here and make it shorter just to freak people out.
It was definitely something that Cliff brought into the ranks, and in terms of some of the melodic aspects of you know, the Ride the Lightning and the Puppets albums and so on, definitely came from him. For people, you know, damn us straight to hell for this, just remember that Cliff Burton would have approved of this. I think one of the key things for us was that we felt kind of, you know, juvenile, and I think that we earned their respect.
In league with Satan Venom, isn't it? No?
I think that as soon as we had played a couple run-throughs of some of his first songs, I think they realized and we felt that it was pretty cool and that we were kind of sort of on even keel in a way, and that there was the same amount of respect coming from them to us as there was the other way.
James, can my friends get your picture with you?
Hell yeah, man.
Come on.
Hey, you want to get the shot with them?
Oh, sure. Here we go.
Move in a little closer. There you go.
Thanks.
All right.
Thanks a lot.
All right, man.
Hey, it's cool.
Okay,
thanks
man.
A lot.
Yeah, no problem.
That was a shitty dress rehearsal.
Well, it's good to know what could happen.
Yeah.
And so if I'm very happy. Like that in Bleeding Me happens, what do we do?
Let's discuss it. Let's have a little bit of a post-meeting about logistics.
Okay. We should take the time now and discuss each beginning and each ending or each middle bit that could fuck up.
At one point or another, we played everything perfectly. We just know there are
a couple of train wrecks.
You're really dealing with a Metallica song, and then within the symphony orchestra, you're dealing with sort of like two or three different musical elements in terms of counter melodies and bits going on. So if you take it as one lump pile of music or whatever, that there's just a lot of shit there.
Kurt,
is James?
Is what we've done with the set list?
You got it.
One, da-la-da-la-da, no power cord in.
Got it?
And then straight into the battery,
into the Sandman.
Into the Sandman.
And the Belfast.
Okay, and then what?
Walk up.
No battery intro, no battery.
Ah, that's the encore. So at the moment, Sandman is back in this.
A couple hours before the show. Very mellow. People that are able to witness this thing live, it's one of those things that you're always going to say, I was there.
Yeah. Going to the show tonight, man. It's going to be kicking. Symphony.
The door's going to be open up and down at 6:30. Shows at 8. Get here early. Don't want to miss out. Hey, it's Rock 92 KSJO. Woo.
Are they all gone?
I didn't even know it went on sale. And then when a lot of my friends called up and said, hey, dude, get me in. Like, what? Go buy tickets. Oh, they sold out. Go. Wow. I'd like to see two worlds out there, you know. The symphony goers and then a Metallica, you know, greasy-haired fan of ours.
Woo! All the way from Detroit!
Are they handing out your books?
I'm here for Metallica! What else, man?
I usher at the symphony, which is one of the reasons I heard about the concert.
I love Metallica. But I've always wanted season tickets to the symphony, too. Then they're best of both worlds!
Well, I was a little Metallica fan, a big symphony fan, and I like the two of them smashing together and kind of like, you know, Adams to make a really big thing.
It's hard to decide how to dress tonight, right? You're not sure. Yeah. You know, usually in orchestra, you go to, like, I overdress. I feel like completely overdressed.
Tell Metallica they're a bunch of losers and they're headed to hell without Jesus Christ. They are ants compared to God, and that God will crush them in his hand, and they will suffer and burn in a lake of fire. You will hear this, and you will be judged on Judgment Day.
We're here to have a good time. I don't want these guys preaching at me about God. I'm Jewish. I don't believe in religion whatsoever.
Why do we blame it on these guys? What they think is wrong? How you take Lord's word is how you take it. All I say is praise Lord and his word. And that's it. Can I get an amen from these believers? Jesus, I'm drinking fucking Steinlager, baby.
Bonding with Metallica.
It's a nice day.
Is this like the height of your career?
It's a real new experience for all of us, I think.
It's certainly one of the more interesting parts. It's hard to say highs and lows and everything. It's certainly cool.
My sister and her boyfriend are huge fans, so I'm hoping to get autographs from you guys.
I collect autographs. This will be one of my nice momentums from playing this job.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
And you.
And I've got from all my students who are very excited. Could you sign a poster for them? Sure. Can you bring it back for us?
I've heard about the harpist. No, he's a cool guy.
So it's done, Peter.
Good.
Are you set for the show tonight?
Yeah, I'm set.
Okay.
Yeah,
well,
I'm psyched up.
The Metallica shirts and regular core Metallica people, there'd be a couple hundred of them in here, right? But they will be the voices that overpower the other thousands. And it will be infectious, there's no question about it. And once they start doing the, and there's five dentists, you know, next to them or whatever like that, and they see this kid doing that thing, and they're like, I'm feeling it, hey, you know, and it'll come, you'll see, man.
We'll see how the audience behaves.
Got your ears on?
Our crowd really doesn't take too well to seated performances.
Gonna be like the who's who of Metallica fans.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Positions. Let's move up the stage.
The whole spectacle of energy and people and confusion and communication and so on, I mean, certainly brought out in us the most intense 2.5 hours on stage we've ever had.
Yeah.
You gotta be nervous, man. There's always a great energy you get from that.
That are getting crazy and want to be definitely on their feet and that kind of thing, and the folks that are not, you know, some friends of mine, maybe not want to be on their feet for too long, and hopefully they'll be able to kind of work with each other and the kids will be a little more understanding.
I think a lot of their perception is that because we're playing with the symphony, things are going to be a lot tamer than they are at a usual Metallica concert. But I say, bring them on.
I might accidentally on purpose push Jason into the crowd to see what happens.
Just being in that moment and being the highest level of awareness in that moment than certainly I've ever had. I really feel that this is not anything other than a complete and true mix of Metallica and an orchestra.
It's meant to be from the beginning of Metallica to play with the symphony, you know, tonight in 1999. It was awesome.
It was very epic.
It was epic.
It was epic. It went along with their music.
Oh, man, it's just unbelievable. It's just unbelievable.
How was it going to spend like one?
It's hard to put in words, man.
Okay.
Wow. What can I say? It's fantastic.
San Francisco Sympathy.
Yeah.
I love playing for this with the San Francisco Sympathy.
Okay, Vinny, it's enough. Get out of here. You guys got enough of this shit for sure. All right, I'm serious.
You sure?
Get the fuck out.
Film him.
Hey, Brendan, can you hold on to this for me?
What's up, Jay?
Yeah.
I got one at least.
This is the dumbest shirt ever. It's great.
Yeah. I'm so nervous of singing like this. Oh my God, Master of
Puppets. See, in my case, this is
just in a case. But see, in my case, I have clothes.
In my case, mine went out during Nothing Else Matters, so I went to Paul. There's nothing in my ear. And he says, we're playing nothing. I go, no, there's nothing in my ear. We're playing nothing.
He's really blocked out all the sound.
Hey, I think I got it in now.
Huh? What'd
you say?
I got it in finally. How's it look? We're not done. Where are you going?
These ear monitors make it so you can hear everything.
We did that bit.
He wasn't here.
Having a good time?
I love it.
You fucking suck me off while we're at it.